Am I on? Yeah. Good evening, everyone. Welcome at the Balie. My name is Myrthe Vreese. I'm a program director here. And I looked it up in my email today, and it was already a year ago that we got this email from an architect, Arna Mackic. And she asked us if we could do a program, maybe make a program around her book, Mortal Cities, a book she had written about the consequences of war for a city and the reconstruction of the, not the consequences of war, but the consequences of war for architecture for a city and what architecture can also do to rebuild a city. And we started to talk, and she had a lot of ideas, because not only did she want to address that, she also told me that she thought that in Western cities, which are dealing with great transformation, segregation, gentrification, that maybe in the West we can learn actually from former war-torn countries. And I thought that was a very interesting idea to work on. And we said, not let's make one program, but make three programs actually. And that's what we did. Tonight is the first one. So tonight it's about rebuilding collective identities after the war. And on the 2nd of June, we will talk about shared cultural heritage in segregated cities. We will really talk about the West. And in September, we really want to address a case study, which we still have to pinpoint which one it will be, because Arna said, I really want to go and talk about what we can actually do, welcome, and not only kind of just philosophical talks about what should be done, but really to come with plans and to involve stakeholders to make also a city like maybe Amsterdam or other city more inclusive. So Arna, it's been a great pleasure to work with you, and I would now like to give the floor to our presenter of tonight, and that is Chris Keulemans. And we asked him because he's very involved with the topic of this whole series. He wrote the introduction for Arna's book, Mortal Cities, that I talked about. But he also recently wrote this article for De Groene about already the rebuilding plans that are being made now in Beirut for Syria. And he talked there with a lot of young and a lot of influential architects. One of them is also here tonight with us. And also another one is also here with us, who is actually now working here in Amsterdam. So it's going to be a very interesting night. Chris, I'd like to give the floor to you.
Thank you, Myrthe. So, I was working here in this building in 1994 when I first traveled to Mostar. It felt like a doomed place, like the nightmare of a city, a memory of a place where people had once lived together, and even that memory was at risk of being shelled at any given moment. I met a friend there, Boro, Bosnian journalist with his skin pulled tight over his sharp cheekbones. He smoked like a demon and he kept making jokes. Those jokes electrocuted my sense of grammar. I lost the ability to articulate coherent sentences. The words, the language that keeps things together, started falling apart. And Boro just went on making jokes. The bridge was no longer there. The famous bridge of Mostar, just this contraption, the fragile reminder of a time when the city was one. Shelling the bridge in 1993 was an act of herbicide. It proclaimed that what was once one city were now two cities. Shelling the bridge was shelling the soul of the city, the unifying story at its core. Without its bridge, the city of Mostar no longer made sense. Over 20 years later, Arna Mackic, back then four-year-old girl in a town next to Mostar, still cannot contain her rage. Today, in her book, she writes, "For me, it has become a dishonest city. The physical killing of Mostar has led to its illegibility. If we cannot read the city, we can never reach a higher level of art. If we cannot read the city, we can never reach a higher level, the art of writing a city." I traveled on to Sarajevo, a city under siege, back in 1994, as it had been since April 6, 1992, exactly 25 years ago today. I arrived on the holy day of Eid, the feast of sacrifice in the Muslim world. And Sarajevo was under siege, or so the Serb leaders proclaimed, because it was a city of Muslims, Turks, Bosniaks. The streets were empty. There was no traffic. I wore a helmet and a bulletproof vest, as I had been told to. My friends waited for me and led me into the office of a theater festival, looking out over the deserted main street, Marshala Tita, and we celebrated Eid with a bottle of whiskey that they had saved for a special occasion and a pack of Marlboro that I had taken with me. There was public space in Sarajevo, but no public, with the exception of people like these running for their lives across crossroads where they were in full view of the snipers in the surrounding hills. The original Sarajevo was a city where cultures and architectural styles overlapped. There were squares and city parks and riversides where friends would meet, and strangers were people that you might not know but still could identify for what they were. The siege generated an outburst of creative energy within the city, a wave of high-profile solidarity in the outside world. Yeah, everybody's in. Creative energy within the city, a wave of high-profile solidarity in the outside world, and a deep conviction that this city, uniquely capable of accommodating difference, should one day be rebuilt as an example to the world. Today, it looks like this. Huge shopping malls financed with Gulf State money looming over the historical center of town, accommodating the wealthy tourists from Dubai, Riyadh, and Abu Dhabi, who have discovered Sarajevo as the perfect holiday destinations. The summers are warm, there are abundant spaces of worship, and comfortable non-alcoholic terraces. The surrounding nature is beautiful, and now they have these air-conditioned shopping malls too, with all the world's famous brands. The Dayton Agreement that ended the war has left the country with an ungovernable division of powers where nothing is possible. Unless you have money, then suddenly everything is. I hadn't been to Beirut for a while when I arrived in late 2006, a few months after the Israeli war, when large parts of the city had been bombed to pieces. Right next to the infamous Green Line that cuts through the center of the city and demarcated the division between the main opponents during the Civil War of 1975 to 1990, I wandered into this neighborhood. It seemed like a mirage, a dream in full daylight of Parisian 19th century architecture. It's called Solidaire, built over the last decade by father and son Hariri. Father Rafik was prime minister when he was killed in a car bomb attack in 2005. Son Saad is the prime minister today. Their love child Solidaire is busy during daytime. At night, it's deserted. Many of the apartments have been sold, but hardly anyone actually lives there. So now Beirut has a historical city center with no history, a pedestrian zone for those who prefer to move around in limousines. A few miles down the road, the Israeli fighter planes had found their main target in that summer of 2006, the district of Haaret Reik, mainly populated by Shia Lebanese and a stronghold of Hezbollah, Israel's fiercest opponent. When we visited, and a number of that Dutch delegation of architects, designers, and activists are in the room tonight, we were shocked into silence. Not just by the scale of the destruction, but also by the feeling that we were not welcome here. The rubble was being cleared away, shops had reopened, a marketplace was bustling with customers, reconstruction was on its way, and we were clearly not invited to be part of it. Different forces were at work here, different money, different views of rebuilding a human environment. Our urge to create playful, inclusive interventions was made to feel naive, out of place, redundant. Tragedy sometimes can maintain a sense of the poetic. The Mostar Bridge, the siege of Sarajevo, they invoke a certain collective nostalgia that might kindle the vision of a shared future. Arna's work, just like the work of her predecessor and source of inspiration, Bogdan Bogdanovic, the architect and designer of inclusive monuments and public spaces in former Yugoslavia, is a fine example. But sometimes the scale of tragedy is so horrific that it can only be replaced by something equally enormous and intimidating. In Belarus, 3 million people out of a population of 9 million didn't survive World War II. Its capital city, Minsk, as you can see here, was completely destroyed. After that war, no time for poetry. When I visited the city last year, I was in awe. The perfect, artificial, spotless, and intimidating model of a Soviet city. The statue of Lenin, in the middle of the picture, stood guard in front of the parliament building. Everything was larger than life, larger than the human scale. Yes, there was public space in abundance, parks, squares, boulevards along the river, but everything was designed to make the human being appear tiny and fragile. And under close and permanent surveillance of the state power that loomed above every human interaction. The city worked to make even the most innocent conversation with strangers look suspicious. Of all the memories that lingered in Minsk, about the horrors of the war, about the bustling trades of the years before, only the official and triumphant version of history remained. Whatever is left of the soul of this old city, it has been negated, oppressed, stamped into oblivion. And yet, for us, city aficionados, armed with not much more than our curiosity and the desire to walk around in spaces that build their energy on the kaleidoscope of differences, the best place to start might still be to go and search for the soul of the city, the intangible story that refuses to be extinguished, the memories that linger, memories that you can recognize even if you're a newcomer here and never took part in them. The stories that shape a city as much as its architecture does. Places like this one, an unremarkable street corner in the Hamra district of Beirut, where once the writers in exile gathered at a cafe called The Horseshoe. Or the old square in Basjasha, the ancient center of Sarajevo, with its wooden fountain, the cobblestones, the tin and copper shops, the pigeons. Yes, most of its visitors today are tourists, and yes, its original value to the local economy has evaporated, but still, it has recovered in an astonishing way from those dark days of the siege, when the shops were deserted, the walls and windows riddled with bullet holes. Whatever the future holds in store for Sarajevo, with its shopping malls and ethnic tensions, it will not be complete without this little old square as a reminder of the poetry that survives when a space is designed to be inclusive. And that poetry has many forms. It can be awkward, a little run down, unspectacular, and still do its service, like this small monument to the victims of World War II at Mosplein in my beloved Amsterdam Noord. The people walking by with their daily groceries, the cyclist speeding past to catch the next ferry boat, they might hardly notice the phoenix on its pedestal. They might not take the time to sit and chat on the simple wooden benches. They might not recognize the faces of local shopkeepers painted on the wall behind the monument. Faces of Duvan, where I buy my cigarettes, or Nick, where I buy my sandwiches for lunch. But this place belongs to the victims of the war, to the shoppers and shopkeepers, to the retired people who sit and gossip, to the homeless and the alcoholics who spend the night on the wooden benches. It belongs to those who are in search of the soul of the city. It belongs to us. Thank you. I was happy to share this story on this occasion in this context to which I feel so committed. But now the real thing starts, so it's my pleasure to introduce three extraordinary people who will be joining us here one by one to discuss the questions that Mirta already shortly introduced, and I touched upon a few of them in my talk. So wartime, how to reconstruct in a way that you still create inclusive spaces, how to give space to the trauma, to the tragedy, but also to the soul of the city. Can we think about that in the stories that are being, in the cities that are being destroyed by war as we speak? We've all seen or turned away from the horrific images in Idlib this week, where innocent citizens and children were killed by chemical attack. At this moment, can we even start to think about rebuilding those cities? People who are into that struggle, we see a few of them tonight, say yes now more than ever, in order not to be too late when it's time. We'll go from Mostar to Beirut to Damascus to Aleppo, and then, as Myrthe introduced, we'll take it back to Amsterdam, to the cities like Amsterdam here in Western Europe, where, I mean, Amsterdam has not been destroyed by war, but it is now facing the similar struggle, maybe, to keep being an inclusive space while processes of segregation are going on. So to begin with, to me and to the other speakers, it would be nice if we can have a little light on the audience for a second. Because I'm just curious to know why the Balie is sold out on a pleasant spring evening to come and discuss the most difficult questions of today. Who here is an architect? Oh, fair number. Including those studying to be an architect. Yeah? Who here is originally from one of those cities we were talking about? A few, including Arna Mackic's family on the second row here. Who thinks it makes no sense to start talking about reconstruction of war-torn cities now that the war in Syria is still going on? One person. We'll hear from you, two. We'll hear from you later, I'm sure. Finally, who thinks it makes sense to try to learn from experience of reconstructing cities after wartime and try to see what we can learn from them here to create an inclusive space in a city like Amsterdam? It's going to be quite a move, but that's what we're here for, and also during programs 2 and 3 of this series. But now, it's high time to present to you the woman who started all of this, Arna Mackic. She has founded with Lorien Beyert recently the studio LA. She's also, last year, she became the head of the architecture department at the Gerrit Rietveld Academy. LA uses architecture and spatial models as an experimental space to investigate social issues. It's very often about collective identity, like it is tonight, and mortal cities and forgotten monuments, about the destruction and reconstruction of the city of Mostar in Bosnia, is just one shining example. So I'm very happy to introduce Arna Mackic on stage.
Hi, thank you.
There's one little technical thing we're not seeing in the image here on the monitor.
No, but I will...
Ah, for the guys upstairs, so we're not seeing the image here on the monitor.
Okay. No, but I can do it like this, it's no problem. So, well, like Chris said, I'm going to talk about the destruction of cities by war and rebuilding them, ways of rebuilding them, by using Mostar, this city in Bosnia-Herzegovina, as an example. And I've divided this talk into 7 short chapters, and the first one is the unwritten rules of the urban environment. So architecture has a strong influence on the way that people feel and also on our daily lives, as these fixed points of reference are fundamental to our sense of space. Each of us has certain buildings, certain squares, certain streets, consciously or unconsciously, that we feel very attached to. And often it is presumed that the city that we live in will be there forever. So we cannot imagine losing our cities, or that the place where we live in, that it will be destroyed or even turn into a ruin. And unsurprisingly, when this happens, people get traumatized because they lose their physical points of reference. And often it seems very far away from us, this idea. It happens somewhere in a country far away. But of course, not a long time ago, and also not far away from here, it was the reality for a lot of European cities that had to start all over again after the Second World War. And I think it's important for us to talk about the situation that happened in Bosnia and also that is happening now in Syria, because we have to relate to it, whether it's far away or not. And well, this is exactly also what happened in Mostar. So 70% of the city got destroyed. And by this destruction also, well, actually all of the inhabitants, no one thought that they would lose their city, that 70% of it would be gone, and that only a specter of what they knew or what the city was would remain. And during... thank you. And well, during and after the war in Bosnia-Herzegovina, architecture played a major role. By describing this role, I will talk about Mostar because of its high personal significance to me. In 1993, I fled Bosnia-Herzegovina together with my parents, my brother and my sister. And in 1999, we went back for the first time to visit the country. And full of wonder, I studied this destructed city and its buildings every summer when we went back. And for me, it was and it still is a very unique but also an unsettling experience to witness a city in such a condition. And it's unique because this city has the unique chance to start all over again, to build a collective identity again. But it's unsettling because of this process that it's going and the way that this is going. Mostar actually, before the war, it used to be the paragon of tolerance. It had the highest amount of mixed marriages in whole former Yugoslavia. And, mixed marriages because historically the inhabitants of Bosnia-Herzegovina have been divided into three different groups based on their religious background, so Islam, Catholicism, Orthodox Christianity. Throughout history, they would relate in varying ways to identity and religion based on the politics of a certain period. But before the war, actually, no one was wondering whether their neighbor was a Muslim or a Croat or Orthodox Christian. These different religions and these different cultures also are shown in the architecture of the city. So it's founded in the 13th century and has a very, it has a rich Ottoman, Austro-Hungarian and also socialist Yugoslavian history. And a very important symbol in Mostar is this old bridge, and it is a symbol for connection between and tolerance amongst different people, different cultures, different periods. But it's also an important public space, or it was an important public space. People would meet here, they would have their first date in this place. And it's also the place where the annual diving competitions are held. And it didn't matter what your religious background was here. The only thing that mattered was if you belonged to the city or not. And this is a ritual that has been done by men since the building of this, the construction of this old bridge, to prove your manliness and to impress women. This is another picture. this war in Bosnia Herzegovina, you could also call it a war against architecture, and not just by targeting arbitrary buildings, but specific symbolic architecture. So architecture that said something about the identification, or actually that said something about the identity and culture of people. So important bridges, museums, important squares, libraries, everything that said something about the collective identity of that place. But by doing this, not only a certain history got erased and a certain collective identity, but also the identification of the inhabitants with the city got lost by doing that. And when that happens, a city actually enters a very dangerous place, gets a really dangerous condition. And that also happened in Mostar. So 90% of the complete city center was destroyed. 1/3 of all of the buildings in the whole Mostar got destroyed. 10,000 of people got killed and displaced from their homes. And well, one of the most notorious legacies of the war is the political and psychological division of the city into two different sides, into a Croat and a Muslim side, both with their own schools, with their own hospitals, fire department, cellular network. So very heavy division. And well, actually, according to this architect that I have been studying, Bogdan Bogdanovic, he says destroyed cities should listen to their own memories and rebuild a new version of themselves with the old one in mind. So architecture is, of course, a fundamental way for people to relate to their surroundings. And now that this relationship has ceased to exist, architecture is put to the task of facilitating new ways of relating to the city without losing the soul of the city. Well, a little bit history to understand also how architecture has been used throughout history in this area. Before the Second World War, this area, actually the borders shifted continuously. There were a lot of conflicts, there were a lot of names for these different areas within this area. But after the Second World War, these six republics and two provinces had to form one country, which was called Socialist Federal Republic of Yugoslavia. And under the rule of Tito, nationalism and religion was suppressed and became a decreasingly important issue. So people that were living, for example, in one of these areas, or Bosnia or Croatia or Serbia, they didn't identify themselves with being a Serb or a Croat, but they identified themselves in being Yugoslavian. So you belonged to, you had the same passport and you belonged to the same country, no matter where you lived in this area. This feeling of unity wasn't surprising, actually, because people here, the inhabitants of these areas, they share history, language, territory, and many other traditions. Tito introduced a strict socialist regime where continuously the similarities were emphasized and mutual dependency. And for that, he used media, education, theater, film, but also architecture. So he commissioned more than 100 monuments commemorating Second World War and victims of fascism. But these monuments didn't recall the Second World War, but they were orientated towards a shared future, a future full of freedom, equality, independence, progress, actually offering a better life for everyone. To appeal to all of these different inhabitants of all these different areas, a new architectural language had to be invented. And this architectural language was intended to be free from symbols referring to victory, war, heroes, nationalism, religion, but they had to be abstract forms referring to a modern future. And in this area, of course, there were a lot of truths and a lot of identities. These monuments had to appeal to all of these different inhabitants, regardless of their location. And they became actually very popular public spaces where people would meet and spend their leisure time. So, and this architect, Bogdan Bogdanovic, he designed 20 of these monuments. I visited the half of these monuments that he designed. And also his monuments lacked symbolism of religion and nationalism, but he did refer to old mythology, to Renaissance and Baroque periods. And his monuments look archaic, ancient, like they will stand there for eternity. And it's very interesting what he says himself. So he, in one of his books, he explains, "I chose non-ethnic and non-confessional symbols, trying to stay as far away from ideopolitical symbols. I often sought inspiration in archaeological materials. I ventured deeper into the world of archaic images. I was looking for ancient imaginative mattresses. I wanted, in terms of the universal human, the presumed anthropological memories to represent war and death, the conqueror, the conquered, and above all, the indestructible joy of life." This is in Mostar, this monument. Well, and still to this day, architecture is being used as a weapon in Mostar. First of all, because of this political and psychological division of the city. Here you can see that, and the white part is actually a neutral zone that is pronounced by the European Union because this city is divided so heavily. And in this white neutral zone, these mutual institution and administrative buildings should be placed, and they are. But this zone is not appropriated by all the inhabitants because it's, well, it doesn't take a stance. It's too neutral, I guess. And on the other hand, there are a lot of political ideas being imposed in public space. And because of this, Mostar has become hazy. So an abundance of fragmented, imaginary, self-proclaimed and self-imposed commemorations are being added to the city's fabric. And it's actually impossible to walk through the city without being reminded by the war. Because the past is being retold in competing ways by symbolic architectural interventions. And I think, and with this also, the communication between the city dwellers and also the city itself has ceased to exist. And it's very important to read the city, to know how to understand the city, because if you as an inhabitant don't know why these political ideas are being imposed, if you don't understand who is doing this and why, then you cannot read the city, but you also cannot take a stance. You cannot go against it because you don't know about it. So that's why I think it's important that these things are being documented also. And what happens a lot in a lot of cities that are destroyed is that buildings with a symbolic value are being rebuilt in the same way as they looked like before the war. And I think in this case of the old bridge, in a way, it's good that the old bridge is again here. On the other hand, I'm really not happy with the way that this has been done. Because UNESCO and the European Union, they rebuilt this bridge and they said, well, now that it's rebuilt, again, this symbolic meaning is again here, the city is again connected. But that's not true, because if you walk 50 meters into one direction or in the other direction, it matters what your last name is or what your religious background is and if you belong on that side or not. So if the meaning of this architecture has changed, do we need it then still? I don't know. A city is not based on one truth or one layer, but it consists of a varied and rich past. And this layered history should be visible in the architecture and the public space of a city when reconstructing it. It shouldn't be imposed upon the inhabitants by bringing the city back into its exact original state. Rather, it should consist of the different layers of the cultural history, and these different layers also, they are needed because they give different points of reference, historical points of reference, to people with different points of view and with different backgrounds. So in that way, they can appropriate the buildings and insert them with meaning, new meaning themselves. Also, ruins shouldn't be cleared always. Structures or parts of the ruins could also be inserted in a way or become one layer of the reconstruction process. And what I did, because I also wanted to test my ideas to see, is there a certain method we could use and can we learn from the way that Bogdanovic worked? So I started doing a case study in Mostar itself, in this neutral zone. And I actually wanted to focus on ancient rituals and traditions that belong to the city, not to a certain person or to a certain group of persons, but really that belong to the city, and how to use those traditions to make new public space. And I did this well in this area, so this is what it looked like just after the war, and this is how this area looks like now. Diving off of the old bridge is a ritual that belongs to the city of Mostar. So boys learned step by step how to jump, and ultimately became skilled enough to jump off the old bridge. And this urban activity actually also remained a shared tradition, and it doesn't matter what your religious background is. This is the old swimming pool of Mostar, so even here the diving board is a bit in the shape of the old bridge. And just after the war also, while this new temporary bridge was constructed, there was also a diving board so that men could jump. So this is really an activity that belongs to the city. Yeah, these are the men that do it, and also women now. So it's a public activity, and it's maybe one of the most logical ways also to connect people again in the city. So I propose a diving school where citizens can learn step by step how to dive, and with the ultimate goal to jump off of the old bridge. Every step is 50 centimeters, and every 50 centimeters in height, it also goes it becomes 50 centimeters wider in both directions, so you get like two wings. And at the same time, it's also a place where people can sit and watch the jump. So in the end of the stairs reaches 18 meters, and after that you can make the next level, and that's the jump of the old bridge. And what is here really, I think it's an individual activity. But in a way, because of the courage that you have to do of jumping off this old bridge, it also connects people. And while the 3-second jump towards the water provides a feeling of weightlessness and freedom, where one becomes detached from everything around oneself, including one's entanglement in the struggles of Mostar. And it's also an empowerment to conquer the city and the architecture for a moment and dive into the future with a new version of the old one in mind. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Arna. one question before we continue. What is the setting you placed us in?
Yeah, I wanted to make a connection between Mostar and Syria here. This is a picture that Mohammed sent me. And I also wanted to make a setting that looks like public space. So these elements like this one bench... Mm-hmm. and where you're sitting on. So to create a setting about the content that we're talking about.
And we'll see that at work, because we'll be joined by more people now.
Yeah.
These are pages from your book, yeah?
Yeah.
To be clear, is your book available here tonight?
No. But it's available in shops and internet.
Okay. Final question. So this is your story about Mostar, and an exemplary story about how you can go into the history and the traditions and the story of a city in order to come up with a design for a shared public space. But now we're going to move towards Beirut and Syria. What triggered you to do that? Because it's already a handful.
Yeah.
To do this.
Yeah. Actually, when I made the first version of this book, it was one version before this one. I was invited to go to Beirut, and I was there for like a week and a half, 2 weeks, and I was really impressed by the city. And by the people, but I also realized that what I was talking about, it was happening also in the same city, in another city, but somewhere else in the world. And that's the first time when I noticed this is happening in a lot of cities, and we're not collecting knowledge about what is happening and not learning from what is happening. And
that is the point. That is
exactly
the point, to learn from these experiences.
Exactly.
So Mohammed Al Mufti is here. Please join us on stage and give him a warm hand. I mean, you created a shared public space yourself, Arna, so we're going to share it. It's easier. So some 2 months ago, we went with a group of people from Holland to Beirut to discuss this reconstruction question. One of the people we met was Mohammed Al Mufti. He's an architect, he's an artist, he's an academic. He graduated from École Nationale Supérieure d'Architecture de Versailles in France. That's where he started his professional career as an architect, social housing, educational project, award-winning. And then in 2008, you returned to Damascus. Are you originally from Damascus? Where you set up your own atelier, started working, educational, cultural, public space projects, but revolution, war started, war broke out, working, living there became impossible, and you moved to Beirut, where you now practice with your studio and teach at ALBA, the Academy of Fine Arts. Take it away.
Okay, thank you. Chris was asking a question at the beginning: is it the right time to talk about reconstructing, rebuilding Syria, or any country in war? Well, it depends what we call, what we consider rebuilding. Rebuilding is not basically the architecture or the stones or the concrete. It's basically building the society, the population, from scratch. So this is mainly the topic I'm gonna discuss tonight. So, maybe one of the very few advantages of the war is that there's a possibility to restart from scratch in many domains, talking mainly about sociology, which is the main topic and the main problem in Syria. But first, let's go quick introduction or about Syria. So this is a picture of Homs back in 2014. This is the current situation, and it even got worse since then. Completely war-torn country or cities, disintegrated social fabric. A lot of people left the country. The economy is completely failed in many regions, many cities. Natural resources are completely wasted, and it became a parallel economy, war economy, that is so. Became an item to put pressure on some areas or some cities. And education evasion. So many young kids cannot go to schools anymore because there are no more schools in many regions, or because they need to work to help the family to live. So even the heritage is greatly damaged. But first, let's talk about since 2011, before 2011, in Syria, there were 23 million inhabitants. Now we're estimated to be 14 million, so the loss is almost 9 million. The loss is not only the deceased people, it's all the categories which are the disappeared, the imprisoned, the refugees, the migrants, the displaced, and this new term, which is the replaced. People now, it's a new trend in Syria. They take them from a city, put them in another city for the diverse reasons, which is maybe sectarian, maybe economical, maybe... And a lot of stones or buildings, physical capital is lost, which is the schools, the universities, the houses, hospitals, roads, bridges, institutional services, facilities, souks, like the souk of Aleppo, urban and architectural heritage, and also on the psychological level, what is lost in a big matter is the hope and the motivation and the ambition of the people inside the country and outside the country. That's because the time factor has played a major role since 2011. The crisis lasted too long. People, Syrians, thought that the crisis would last like all like the other Arab Spring countries. Well, in Syria, it turned out to be the disaster case. Just before talking about reconstructing Syria, rebuilding Syria, I just need to point some couple of information so dreamers would stop dreaming that tomorrow we're going to start building the country. The estimated loss, according to ESQA report, capital loss in general is $330 billion, and that is until 2016. So since then, things got worse. And this is the division according to per sector. What we're talking about now as architects or interested in rebuilding is the first one. It's building and construction, which is 30%. So out of 330 billion, 30% is lost. So we need $110 billion. According to potential investments, after war stops and after sanctions are lifted, we will estimate the investment or donations up to $200 million. And they're divided according also per sector, and the building and construction sector only is 20%, so it is $40 billion. So there's a loss of $70 or $60 billion. So basically, we're talking about a population mutation. There's no room for everybody anymore. And so what are we rebuilding for? Are we rebuilding for the same 23 million people who were before in Syria? Or are we reconsidering a new Syria with a new territory eventually, with a new population? So the basic process of rethinking of building post-war is a process in two phases, usually. The first one is called peace building. That is to rehabilitate the social peace, the economical system. And the investments, whether from World Bank or whatever, will only try to play a role in the capacity in building the economy to make it sustainable to go to phase two, which is the real reconstruction, the state reconstruction. So there will be 3 years, 3-4 years, which is only theoretical, basically, with no real reconstruction. That is, if war stops, war ends, not stops. The case of Lebanon, in comparison, the war in Lebanon didn't end, it stopped. So it's a process that could be launched again, hopefully not. But if one day in Syria there's a real peace and a real end to the war, we can go to this process. So the first one is up to 3-4 years. The second one is the one we're not gonna talk about actually, which is the reconstruction, the physical reconstruction of the country. But the outcome of the first phase is the main indicator of what Syria will be, because this is where the system will take shape and the population will take shape. The country is for whom? What's the new system ruling the country? What are the targets? What is the vision? Is it in the same territories or divided or redistributed, etc.? So depending on the outcome of the first phase, we can then talk about the second phase and see who eventually is interested to rebuild. Now, the fundamentals in all this is fundamental questions. Is the population, who are we? If we consider the war ended tonight, which is not the case. Who's in, who's out, who wants to go back to Syria, and who wants to stay outside Syria? I'm talking about migrants, refugees, etc., that may be home in other countries, European countries, etc. Who would want to go back? It's a very difficult question. And how many are we? So the country is for how many people? What's the capacity? The new state building, the new state system, is it an authoritarian? So are we going back to the same old system? Is it an autocracy? Are we going to religious thinking? Is it a democracy, centralization, federalism, etc.? And the economical system, is it a financial, what are the financial and banking capacities? What about the sanctions that are that are still there and they will not be lifted overnight? It's a very long process. And we know Iraq, Saddam left, but the sanctions are basically still there. Fiscal policy. So these are main parameters that we cannot control as architects. Yeah. But there's a breach in all this to talk about reconstructing or rethinking reconstruction is in this first phase where nobody is going to play a role, basically, because war ended and there are people working only on rebuilding the system. So the remaining people, the local population staying in Syria, it's there where it can happen. And thinking of how can these people be participative in rebuilding the country and public space, and start by public space. Because public space, nobody will invest in public space, nobody will invest in schools, in social housing, in those kind of projects. So the public space is an... But it's too far. Oh. Can't read anything. So, with all these parameters, we know that the reconstruction will not start tomorrow. It's going to be a process, it should be a process that is a grassroots process, starting with the voids and public spaces with the minimal intervention of local population. When war ends, these people remaining in those cities, destroyed cities, if they secure and invade the public space and regenerate activities and program, this is maybe the only way, maybe, to reconstitute peace between the different sides and to recreate an economy, a service life, education, culture. So, defining public space as a functional and sustainable program hosted in voids in a vernacular approach. So we're talking about public space not as a classical definition with a space hosting memorials or green areas like parks that nobody uses or symbolic statements. It's really a program, architectural program, without a roof, basically. Secure public space and provide essential needs like trade, education, connectivity, leisure, culture, social fabric rehabilitation, playgrounds, hosting services, sports, etc. The whole life should be regenerated by the void, and then people eventually will think of coming back. To secure public space in phase one, displaced population would consider a return. To encourage community work, motivate and involve local population in setting a real program in phase two. This is maybe the only way to really assure a democracy in a second phase. It's when the local population participate in the book of requirements of their cities, of their districts. So according to their experience in the first phase, they can play a role in the second one. Until now, why is public space a very important issue in Syrian culture? Because we have a very particular relation according to the era we went through, whether under French mandate or under, before that, the Ottoman Empire, or under dictatorships, or under during war, and maybe post-war we're going to have again a different relation with the public space. And maybe this is the occasion to develop it. And I'm giving an example of a place in Homs, a square in Homs called the Clock Square. On the left, it's the way it was before the uprise. On the right, it's when the revolution started and people started protesting. And the symbol of the clock was copied as a model and put as a symbol of a revolution in every single city. And then when the regime took again Homs, he invaded the same square to make a point that we're back again, we're holding the city again. And this is mainly the only use of public squares, of public spaces. It's a demonstration of force. It's not really a use, a daily use. And the regime and all sides during the war, they knew this fact and they were systematically shelling, bombarding the public spaces to avoid this kind of cohesion between the communities, between the people. And we've seen many pictures of souks, vegetable markets, etc., being bombed, or bakeries where people gather, bombed, etc. So basically, the idea that is interesting is to consider all these activities that is related to culture, to education, and to joy, to build them all in a public space without a roof, and reconsider maybe the definition of architecture. Is it still a shelter? Or is it a space and an inclusive one? So, thank you.
Okay, you're not making our life easier, Mohammed, clearly. You just lined out the enormous challenges we're facing. Somebody who's not afraid of that is Bengin Dawood. Would you join me here on this little bench?
Yes.
And give him a warm hand, people.
Mm-hmm. Right. It's a nice bench here. Do you come here more often?
Thanks.
We should. We will come here more often. You got it? Okay. Bengin, we know each other well.
Yeah.
You've been in Amsterdam over 4 years now.
No, yeah, I think so.
Architect, urban designer, originally from, studied in Damascus, but the war forced you to escape first for a few months to Beirut.
Yeah.
For about half a year. And then you came here. You now work at Common Affairs here in Amsterdam, the office, and advises the city of Amsterdam on the development strategy of the refugee camp of Zaatari in Jordan on the border with Syria. And you also introduced the concept of the soul of the city, which is focusing on the reconstruction of post-conflict cities, as we're talking about, where you want to involve a wider set of disciplines than just architects and urban planners. But also people from the social sciences, as Mohammed also pointed out, and including the former and the current citizens themselves, of course. Bengin, if we listen to these two stories, first we have the imagination of a new public space, a shared public space within the contested neutral zone of a divided city, by Arna Mackic. Mm-hmm. What do you recognize in her design? What do you recognize in her way of working?
Yeah, what I was writing some notes while we were explaining that, because you mentioned a lot, of course, the culture and the history we want to elaborate on and we want to bring back. But what I noticed through the years I was searching for the soul of the city, how it's called also, I noticed that actually the tradition, in the sense of the old tradition, is not interesting anymore. It's the living tradition. So that was, for me, it was shocking a little bit, because we always have this conflict between ourselves immediately when we get a new thing. Okay, how does it work? And of course, I refer to experience things. So for me, it was fascinating to see that actually people change. yeah, especially when there's conflicts, when there's disasters, when there's, and then the living tradition and their habits change as well. So I find it fascinating what you're trying to do, of course, and I'm more intrigued, how can you take it a step further? Eh? How can it be pushed further than only, I mean, this is a tradition in Mostar, eh? Jumping from the bridge, showing this power, but what's the new tradition which might connect the both? And that was for me, that's intriguing for me in what you're doing in the neutral space in Mostar.
Respond to that, Arma?
Yeah, I think you're right, I completely agree. But I also think that it is important to create places where these new traditions can start. Mm-hmm. And if you don't have these places where people can meet, then of course these new traditions cannot even start
that's
happening.
That's your next project.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's when old traditions solidify and can sometimes become the symbols of conservatism instead of inclusion. Now we're listening to Mohammed. You two had been Skyping before, but never met in real life until today in this nice little public place in Amsterdam. When I listen to Mohammed, on the one hand, I'm depressed because the job is so huge.
Yeah.
On the other hand, the way he describes it in this first phase of peace building, the first phase when the big investors will neglect the social side of reconstructing cities. First phase when you say we should work with and from the communities. That sounds like a time and an environment when people like you, the searchers for the soul of the city, let's say the softer planners, could actually find some space to maneuver and create once the war is finally ended.
I would say even before it's ended. You mentioned I worked for 2 years with the municipality of Amsterdam on the camp in Jordan, and why I'm. After that, I decided to start the search already and to start the process already, because I noticed there, for example, we mentioned all those big numbers we need, but if we watch reality sometimes, that's why I trust people. There's $50 million running business in the camp every month, created by people. No international power was involved, no money from the World Bank came in. And the strange part is that people generated all this on their own.
So how many people are there in camp now?
At that time, there were around 90,000 people, and now there's 84,000, I think.
Creating a $15
million running business without support. They just started. And what fascinates me there, of course, it was very intriguing for me because I always had trust in people, and I got it back in a way, like I became optimistic out of that also. That people knows how to negotiate, how to start over their life. And then, of course, we need the big facilities. Eh? We need, basically all the infrastructure and all those big numbers and institutes, all this will come. But I was more thinking, why shouldn't we already start? Because the challenge is as big as we explain it, mm-hmm. but the people are not aware of it. Mm-hmm. And the first thing they will do is to get safe, to get their shelter right, to
start. Could you go one step further and say that this human capacity for starting to rebuild might even be a part of the peace process?
Yeah, I think.
I hesitate to call it that, but still, at least being a factor in the long road towards peace?
I think so, because my experience in the camp, that people start negotiating their environment differently, they start building new social patterns in the camp, and they start the use of public space differently as well. So they already, and that's for me the living tradition. I mean, they changed. Mm-hmm. When I was there, I was shocked. Those are not the people I met before. But then I started getting their new habits. So they created new tradition for themselves, and they started already the process. And there was, for example, just small example, conflict between people from Homs and Daraa, because the majority is from Daraa. Mm-hmm. So you see how those people from Homs have to prove themselves on a higher scale just to keep. So, I mean, and that's part of the peace process. Mm.
Okay, and also part of reproducing the tensions that led to the war in the first place. Let's move to Beirut. Here's the famous Corniche, the ocean side. And both of you, I mean, Bengin, you've spent time in Beirut twice as a student, as a young architect, and later on before coming here. Mohammed, you've lived there now for how long?
I've been there for 5 years now.
Sorry?
5 years now.
5 years. What we see here didn't exist before the war, before 1975, I'm sure.
It was different. It existed, but it was different.
All these skyscrapers and hotels?
Yeah, no, that's different.
Yeah. The thing is with Beirut, it's being built so insanely fast at such a speed that there is no public space left whatsoever. Could you comment on this?
Yeah, I found this map intriguing because it's a repérage of public spaces in Lebanon, accessible in Beirut. Sorry,
in Beirut,
the green spaces, the public spaces, etc. And compared to
so the darkest parts are green.
Yeah. Uh-huh. And there's the accessible part.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Inaccessible area is the beaches.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
The beach is privatized, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's in a city that is so dense, and that is where reconstruction was really uncontrolled. It was crazy, without any vision, global vision, urban vision, or state vision for the whole country. So it's like private investors building because the laws allow, and the country, the city is suffocating. It's becoming an obese city with very tiny streets and serving huge buildings. So
let's, for a minute, skip to this one. This is the Martyr Square in the center of town before 1975. Beautiful, stylish, busy, and this one's today. So, total reconstruction, new mosque, the only relic is the old cinema remaining here. Solidaire, the neighborhood I was talking about, just to the left. And what strikes me in this picture is, in the diagram just now, the earlier one, can you show that, Mirta? Yeah? So, it's actually this zone, yeah?
No. This is the, it's called
the park.
Hush Beirut, it's down, it's, it's very different.
It's the one up.
Where you see the square up there? It's it's not that, but somewhere there. Okay.
But then to return to today, and we can keep that picture on for a while, you see all the new construction, but you don't see, and you see even kind of place that could be public space, but you don't see people. Why not?
Public space is a culture. It's not the space by itself. I think it's not enough to put a bench and a tree to generate the culture of a public space. I'm not talking about this, but it's beautiful.
but here they did the opposite, right? They didn't place any benches. They actually just made a street for cars.
So yeah, but there's this little spot there on the right.
Yeah.
And there are some areas where there are a couple of... The square you mentioned on the plan is a park called Sanaya. Uh-huh. And it's full of benches, trees, etc. Yeah. But it's not really public space. It's a park. It's a different definition. A public space is the void that is invaded. It's a street, basically. You go there whenever you want. And
so the culture is also different. Let's say from here that the street is your public space. Yeah. That's where you go. That's where you meet your friends. That's where you sit on summer nights.
You're not restricted.
Arna, that means that we might have to look differently at a city like Beirut because it hardly has public space or green space, but still it's very lively, as you've seen during your visit. Mm-hmm. I had one question for you. You said in your story about Mostar that it's so important after the war to make the layers of the city visible. Yes, you're going to build new buildings, new environment, but keep the layers of the city visible. My impression of Beirut, totally without plan and being built like crazy, is that if there is one city where you see the many layers of the wars and the occupations and the different cultures and styles, you see all those layers all the time, all over the city. So apparently Beirut looks exactly like what you wish for.
Good question. Well, I think what struck me the most in Beirut is actually this public space that you're talking about that is not, you cannot reach it. There was even the spark, well, now it opened up, but it wasn't open to public at all. So now they opened it up, but I think only for tourists it was available to enter it, or on Saturdays maybe if you had like a doctor's recipe that you had to go to the park. But that struck me the most that these beaches are privatized. So everything that makes life more like better and more fun, going to the beach, going to a park, that they closed it off. It's like saying to your citizens.
Sure, but then people sit in the streets or on the roofs or wherever. Yeah. But still, one thing is for sure, even in a picture like this, you can see 10 different layers of history and culture and styles.
Yeah.
So that is maybe whoever is responsible in that chaotic place could cherish that. Bengin, do you know about the history of the reconstruction of Beirut after 1990 and again after 2006? Do you know who was in charge, if there was a plan, if there were architects like you guys rushing in with visions?
No, that's the problem. There were the architects were not in the lead, not city planners either. It was international power and international investment and political party mostly. And Beirut, I think, is a clear example of also what happened in the war and continued after. So the area when the Hariri party is involved, it's built differently because the money comes from Saudi Arabia, and then there's money come from Iran for another area. So I think that's what I discovered mostly in my simple research so far, that actually those players kind of misuse us sometimes even, and we need to be aware of that. And I think we are not taking the lead in the sense that we actually, as we said now, it's time to think of Syria because we are already late. Mm-hmm. Because I just to mention, in 2012, before I leave the country, there were companies from Dubai approaching architects to have master plans for homes. Mm. So there's already plans, and those plans depends on the party who will take the lead in Syria. Yeah. And then we might sit here, I hope not, after 20 years and talk about what happened wrong in Homs and Halab and all the destroyed cities, and I hope not. Yeah. So, and again, Chris, I believe that this is a clear example that we don't need to do the same mistake. We need to step up, we need to change our tools, our games, the way we communicate about this.
In order not to get that monsters like the shopping mall in Sarajevo.
Yeah.
Mohammed, living, working, walking, driving in Beirut, seeing how the city is transforming in these post-war years, does that, like Bengin says, trigger you to mobilize the forces of imagination now in order to be on time and in the lead when Syria is open?
Yeah, of course, but I mean, it's regardless Lebanon or Beirut, it's a feeling as a Syrian, of course, we...
Yeah, but we're looking at this as a source of inspiration, good or bad.
Yeah, it's not really comparable because... when the war stopped in Lebanon, the institutions collapsed. So there's like really, how do you call it, randomness in ruling the country. And as Bengin said, it's according to political powers or parties distributing the things. In Syria, until now, regardless of the head of the regimes and et cetera, the institutions are still strong and the laws are still being applied at some point. Syndicates are still working, etc. So institutions are still strong. So we cannot use Lebanon or Beirut as a resemblance case study. It's going to be a bit different. But again, in Beirut there are several mistakes, but there are very interesting things that happened also. Despite everything, in some districts that were not in the and the target of those big investors, well, in those districts, the soul remained, the soul of the city remained, and it went through. I mean, it's still living.
Yeah. Let's move to Syria then. The first picture we just saw, this is the market in Aleppo, yeah, Mohammed?
Yeah.
Next one, Bengin, is what?
It's Damascus. The main market in Damascus.
The main market in Damascus. How does it look today? Do you know?
Well, not as lively as now, but at least my information is not destroyed, luckily. Mm-hmm. I hope it's not going to get destructions. But it's, of course, different because the people are afraid, of course. It's not as lively as I experienced it.
Mm-hmm. And this picture would be from when?
I think it's from 2008, 2009.
Something like 10 years ago.
Yeah.
Now, Bengin, how do we move from this memory, this glistening, brilliant, colorful memory, through the experience of today, this, when marketplaces, because they're crowded, are being targeted, as we saw in Sarajevo back then, towards a next phase?
Yeah, that's our task, I think. I think, look, people's relations to their public spaces change, especially when there's a fear involved, of course. Mm. Fear of, I mentioned lately on the dinner tonight also about the sniper story, how people adapted to it. That was, of course, I think people are very much adaptable to it. And I think the need of a market will appear again. And yes, the clearest, the youngest example of Syrian people specifically reproducing a market is in Jordan. And I think in more camps also, they really restart. They don't need that much. They just need a wide street enough to put their shops and just start
it. Mohamed, you're saying even that it happens today in Syria, like this picture shows.
Of course, yeah.
Whenever the bombs are not falling, people put the fruit on a table.
And when now they're so used of the shelling that when they see an airplane, they just stay in the street and look at it like this, where the bomb is going to fall. Mm-hmm. And they just continue the activity.
Mm-hmm.
Human beings are... strange creatures.
Yeah.
But Arna, once we hopefully finally get through this phase, as Bengin said, there will be a lot of pain, memory of loss, of horror, trauma. How should that be given a place in the new cities that will be built?
Well, yeah, I think it should get an important place because, of course, now the war in Syria is going on for quite a while. So there's a whole, generation almost that kind of grew up with it. So it's important that it becomes one of these layers in the reconstruction process. So not to deny it as if it never happened. But
you give us an example of how to include it in the new inclusive spaces?
Well, for example, you could leave ruins, or you could leave ruins and build new structures in them or around them to leave also some traces of the war.
But not to go into this crazy, wild growth of monuments like you showed us in Mostar.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. And I think what you just said, like, of course, it's really difficult to compare Lebanon with Syria, but I do think that we should, I think that there's this important task also for the international community to say, okay, there are some meaningful historical places, public spaces, and we should secure them. Mm-hmm. We should not give them away to these investors or political parties or whatever. We should really secure them, and we should work on it that these places become inclusive spaces. And I think that is really...
It's surprising for me to hear you say that, because you were just talking about Mostar, a place where that exactly happened. The international community in charge of restoring order said this is public space.
Yeah, but they gave it away to the city. So they didn't do anything to secure this, to secure public space.
And now it doesn't work as
and
a shared
also,
space.
I think what is an important thing is that there weren't any working methods. And I think if I'm working here on these working methods, and you're working on working methods in Lebanon, and you're working on it, why don't we share this knowledge? Yeah. Why don't we make a book out of these working methods and just give it to to these international communities and say, okay, we're going to work with this.
That's why we're here, actually.
Yeah.
Mirta, could we see the next picture? Because it's, this is so much more peaceful to look at. Mohamed,
less painful,
one of the few let's say, optimistic signs that you're giving us is that the big investors will come into Syria. As Bengin says, they're already making plans, setting up investments. But very obviously, certainly in the first phase, they will neglect the public space, the public services, the schools, maybe the hospitals, but in general, the public domain. Do you see a chance there for unwealthy and unpowerful people like us to start working with the citizens?
Oh yes, of course, definitely. But just want to go back to something. What I said is very optimistic, because if reconstructing starts tomorrow, it's gonna go bad. The country is gonna fail. So it's better to really go through those two phases and find a breach in the first one and work grassroots. It's not.
I see what you mean. Because Bosnia, the new state, was immediately put in place, and that backfired as well. But still, this question: when the big money will neglect public space, is there an opportunity there?
Of course, of course. And already things are, lots of sides, our parties are working already and connecting with local populations and some areas that are really in a very bad shape, economically and even housing and infrastructure. Things are already happening, but on a very small scale. Thank you.
Because I translate that, Bengin, into an opening for your way of thinking that would give us some time and space to go and search for the soul of the cities that are now destroyed. How do you see that happening? Would you go around the streets of Homs and ask everybody, what did you eat for breakfast 20 years ago? Or what's the idea?
Yeah, this might be a long-term way. This might work also. I think, Chris, people always carry something with their past with them, and they will never forget it, I think. And then if I watch the numbers of people displaced, we can start there. And I think we can start already with the majority of the people, which I believe they will go back first, which are in the context of Syria still, from Turkey to Beirut to Lebanon to Jordan to Iraq. Because those people, for example, are not living, they are really living temporary, and they carried a lot of their traditions, their habits, and they, of course, adapted to the crisis, and they are building up new futures. And I think we can find a lot of elements there to start with, to also understand what are their hopes, their wishes, their dreams. And I think this can happen in many, several ways, in a playful way, or also in educational ways, in awareness way. You can get a lot of information out of that. And beside that, we have all the experts, of course, from sociologists to psychologists to social economists to politicians even, who understand the complexity of those settings, who can also come and work together along the journey with us to reach that.
Arna, in between, and then I want to return to you, Bengin. From your experience in Mostar, in Bosnia in general, traumatized, damaged people coming out of the war, having learned to suspect the other, to fear the other, to hate the other. To what extent are they capable of starting to imagine the collective, the shared?
Yeah, good question. I think if you provide space where that can happen, of course, people are open for it. But what happened in Mostar, of course, is all these political ideas that have been imposed by these commemorations that are being placed in public space. And of course, that changes your way of dealing with other people if you're kind of bombed with all these different political ideas, then it's really difficult to reach out. And if there are not any spaces where people can meet, then all these prejudices are also going
on. That means
on.
Your work has to be effective on the other public level, the level of public information and media as well.
Exactly. It goes on many levels. I also believe in this grassroots, but also on dealing with it on a high political level, on all these different levels. It should be dealt with.
Okay. Bengin, you just said everybody who moves, who has to flee, will take something with him. Memories, traditions, knowledge, wisdom. Let's see a picture from Amsterdam. What did you bring to our city that helped you look at our city in a different way than I would?
What I brought here, of course, I think this is the Tappermarkt, if I'm not wrong. I always get fascinated because you can find your place in a marketplace. It's so fascinating. But what I brought with me, I start noticing because I live in the east part of the city and I see how the gentrification is happening. And I'm so worried about that, to be honest.
You're seeing Javastraat here?
As well. That's a better example because it's happening.
How do we see gentrification happening here? Walk over to the walk into Dapperstraat.
Well, not walking to it, but I think if you see those elements in the street, it looks fascinating because you have the Italian shop next to the Turkish next to that. But if you go walk there, you will see the privileged white sitting in this hip shop, and then the foreigner Turkish are sitting in this shop. They never mix, and there's a lot of new shops of this hype coming in Javastraat because of the name of Javastraat, and new bars, and it's really crowded. And I'm all the time like, yeah, but there was space for all the people, and now all of a sudden it's one big economical driven street all of a sudden. And I'm worried about that because I've seen the process for the last 3 years. It's going so quick.
It's one of the dilemmas. All of us are in love with marketplaces because they are the traditional place where people meet and feel fine, etc. Market is also economy driven. Yeah. So it's a fine line between old school market and shopping malls.
It's a fine line. But for me, still, if I tomorrow don't find, for example, the guy who have the stuff I miss from Syria in his shop, not there anymore. I'm not going to go to the market.
Because he's there now. And
he might leave because somebody will pay higher rent.
Yeah.
So then I'm not included in that place. Yeah. Mm. That's simple.
So in the end, all of us should move to Amsterdam North. We'll be...
I'm getting more convinced. Yeah.
Mohammed, just to check before we dive into Amsterdam, I just seriously want to check. Yes, we can talk about this image as an illustration of gentrification process in Amsterdam going on today, which might lead to further segregation. But is it ethical to look at this with the same serious concentration that we were just looking at Beirut, Damascus, Aleppo? I just want to make sure.
I think everything is important, but you cannot treat all these subjects with the same emergency or the same priority. In Beirut, nobody's dying. Here, nobody's dying. In Syria, the chemicals are being dropped on people. So it's a different, I think, context. War is still there. Here, there are, I don't know well Amsterdam, but eventually there are maybe urban problems, etc., that can be fixed without blood, without any revolution, without anything. It could be just smart intervention. And
So it's actually timely that we, with the perspective we have on the war-torn cities and their reconstruction, that we think about the cities we live here in the West. Might be timely. It might sharpen our gaze. That's why you want to do this, Arna, I think. That's why you want to do this exercise, to bring the experiences back to our own cities.
Yeah, exactly. Also, by understanding our own cities, we can also understand better what is happening in cities like Aleppo and the other cities in Syria. I think it's, of course, priority is in cities where that are being bombed, where chemicals are. I mean, that the priority is definitely there. So this is just a luxury problem, of course, but I think it is very important to also understand our own cities.
Yeah. Next picture, Rotterdam, Markt Hall, Old Market. I mean, however people love the Old Market and the new Markt Hall, it does illustrate the separation that we're talking about here. But Arna, you're going to take us to this place here in Amsterdam, which is really a serious example of clashing cultures.
Yes. Well, this is the Belmar Bias, so it's a former prison. And in August, 600 refugees, asylum seekers, mostly from Syria, but also Eritrea and other countries, moved here. So they live here in a cell, which is quite heavy to see. On the other side of the prison, in the former offices, Lola Lick is. That's this area. So there are a lot of entrepreneurs, small offices that also contribute something to the to the refugee center by
including your own,
including my own. Yes, with education, network, work sometimes. But if you go to the picture, this picture, mm-hmm. then you see here a new part of the city is being built next to it. Well, you already see it. It's fenced. Yeah. State Amsterdam, state of the art of living.
On this side already, on the other side of the railroad track already, there's a lot of new high rises.
A lot of residential area here, also residential areas. And then on the next to it, you see the Balmer Bias prison with bars on the windows where people sleep, where refugees mm-hmm. sleep. And I just cannot understand why the
and
city...
And to be clear, most of these people now living in the former prison are people who have been accepted here, yeah?
Yes, they have been accepted, so they have a status...
They're not still waiting for the reply, but they have been accepted.
Yeah, exactly. They're waiting for a home to get a real house.
So is this... Why did you move into this place when you think it's such a bad move to put refugees in a former prison cells?
Well, yeah, because I think I could also just from my hip office in somewhere else in the city, I could think about it and write about it and imagine it, but I could also be in the middle of it and also learn of what is happening mm-hmm. There. Mm-hmm. So that's actually the main reason.
Bengin, you go there regularly. Froni and you and I work on Ondertussen creating interspaces for people without and with refugee background, focusing on this place as well. City of Amsterdam didn't have an asylum seeker center. Yeah. City of Amsterdam promotes itself as a tolerant, open city. Mm-hmm. So they wanted to house their share of the incoming refugees. So they had to look for a vacant building. Now here you have a huge vacant building with all the facilities. Why is it such a bad idea?
Why is it such a bad idea? Because I had a conflict personally when I had really a choice to choose. Shall I make a statement and don't work, or shall I try to make the life of those people better? This was for me a personal conflict also before I see this, of course. And yes, I understand maybe we don't have enough houses in Amsterdam, but I think that's the most, in my opinion, insulting way of welcoming somebody in your city. This is my personal opinion, of course. I would say if you ask students to live in this jail, they will find it cool. They will have a lot of fun because it's a fascinating building. There's a lot of space, there's a lot of open space downstairs, there's big spaces, but as a newcomer, somebody just enters the city, end up behind a bar, I don't find any explanation. So for me, I'm going regular there because we try to create these interspaces between mm-hmm. the people inside us, let's say, and their new context, of course. Mm-hmm. And it's challenging every day when you walk in because, of course, we enter the main building as well and the towers, and I've seen it. And I'm not happy to say also, because I'm aware of the new, as it's saying, the Houthaven coming, that the rooms there will be even smaller than those.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, but also I think if you make a decision as a municipality to make this an asylum seeker center, then you should do the two most important architectural interventions. The first one is removing this wall around mm-hmm. it, this huge wall, and the second is removing the bars, and then the third is making good meeting spaces inside of this prison, which still didn't happen.
The walls are here and the bars are on the windows. And you are working on meeting spaces now.
Well, actually, that's what with my studio we have proposed to work on these meeting spaces, but we weren't asked for it. We had to propose it.
But that's the way to work with COA.
Yeah. But that's the crazy part of it.
Mohammed, outsider's view on this phenomenon. Lebanon has an insane amount of refugees from Syria. I believe one in four people in Lebanon is a Syrian refugee. they more or less mingle into the cities, but also mingle into the camps outside of the cities, partly old Palestinian camps, been there for decades. What is, how do you say, more natural, more accommodating to leave people to organize their own new community and environment, or to control them in an existing but at least dry space with hot water, showers and kitchens?
I think in both ways it's creating ghettos. Mm. Whatever the structure is, whatever the value of the architecture is. I mean, this looks like brand new buildings, actually high-end buildings in Beirut. Mm.
You're being too kind. You're being too kind.
Yeah.
So it's just the fact that you just make a wall, a compound, and you say this category of people is there. You say this is a ghetto.
Yeah.
So whatever the structure is, but just back to your question. Legally, there isn't any Syrian refugee in Lebanon. Mm. It's a different terminology.
Yeah. Mm.
If a country hosts refugees, then the country has duties towards this refugee.
Yeah. Yeah.
Lebanon considers they are displaced and temporary visitors. So all those 1 to 4 Syrian to present in Lebanon, they're not refugees.
They're not officially refugees, so the state doesn't have to take care
exactly.
of them.
Exactly. And that's why they're spread all over the city.
So. And whatever you think of this, but at least the state is taking care of the refugees here. Arna, finally, and then I want to go to the audience. Can we have the next slide of Lola Lick? Yeah. It's the same municipality who has allowed you and Simon van Dommelen and others to create this open space for education, for culture, for arts, for meeting next to in the former entrance building to the prison. It's the same municipality who did that. So it's a fascinating experiment. I would say it's not an example of segregation, it's an attempt towards inclusion.
Yeah, that's true. It's an attempt of inclusion inside a segregated area.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Good. Now, and one more thing before we turn to the audience, what has struck me all the time during your presentation of tonight and in the promotion material before is that you say we should learn from post-conflict cities because we're facing conflicts here, discrimination,
Segregation.
And
gentrification.
I don't believe I've seen it so publicly stated that we live in a segregated city here in Amsterdam. That's quite a statement.
Yes. I think it's also, I told you before, the place where I grew up in the Netherlands, in Zoetermeer. I grew up in this huge apartment building where hardly any Dutch people were living. So I kind of grew up segregated. I didn't know what being Dutch meant. I saw it on TV, but I didn't see my neighbors on TV, people that looked like my neighbors on TV. So I kind of, this idea, I knew it, and then I moved to Amsterdam, and everyone people from all over the world are living here. But now I just see that there's a big gap between people that have money and that don't have money.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the segregation is more in these terms.
Yeah.
And I think we really should deal with it, otherwise we get like a monotone city, and it's not what we want.
Yeah, and then we get, like you just described, attempts towards inclusion within segregated areas.
Yes, by people that are really kind and really want to do well, good. And I mean, it's what Lola Lick is doing is wonderful. But if the conditions are not right, I mean, we should work on these conditions.
Yeah.
That's important.
Yeah. Yeah, because otherwise Amsterdam will be a segregated city, like Paris, the city that you've lived in for a long time, also threatens to become. Yeah. So if we can have some light, then I will come over to you. Aha, Fronibisma ondertussen.
I want to make it a question. What's exactly inclusive? I think this is a sacred. I'm not going to make a question of it. I think this is a building where the segregation is so obvious. So in the one place they're paying young people to work, and in the other building are living people in the asylum seeker centers. And it's a good story that they work together, but I don't see it. I don't see the people from the asylum seeker center building marketplaces, dealing in the... So it's people working for other people. And I think that's, even if you think about rebuilding city, that's the great risk there as well. People thinking for people and not people asking, do you want to build this place? Or do you...
Well, that's not, I mean, maybe Simon can react. That's not exactly
You first, Arna, and then Simon van Dommelen.
Yeah, I don't know exactly what you mean with people working for other people.
No, it's like you always say, if you want to do something meaningful, you should work with the people, like in the community-based approach that you were talking about, for the people.
Yeah, that does happen at Lola Lick in that area. That definitely does happen because we do, and Simon and all these other parties involved, everyone is really working with asylum seekers. Mm-hmm. We're not Simon, saying to them what to do or...
You're one of the people who took the initiative. Could you stand up so everybody can admire this fine specimen of a young man? So what would you say to this obvious...
Yeah, I don't agree. Actually, in this space, we want to make lots of public spaces and then make it equal so everyone can come there and go there. So
including the prison buildings itself.
The refugees themselves as well. And we create office spaces as well for refugees. So there are refugees who have their own company already in this building and work there. Of course, there are some organizations who give language courses and so on. So they are like, but they give them as well an opportunity to grow and grow up. But the main task of Lola Lick is to create a space that is like an Amsterdam space, not a refugee space like Goa. It's also not a closed building, so Amsterdam people come in. But the interesting thing is that because it's like an incubator space, so we bring in there are 70 companies inside, and they all bring their own network. And refugees come in as well, and they bring their networks and their own ideas as well. And they mingle together. And we bring in like the Amsterdam Creative City, like the Amsterdam networks, the different kind of small-scale networks, and who go over the whole world, we bring them to these people, and people can come in and do whatever they want, and they can join companies, or they can create their own company, start their own company, and they do, actually. So, and it's not only for the asylum center, it's all for refugees from all over the city, and for Amsterdam people as well.
And by the way, Lola Lick at least has been open, what, now a month? So it's still
a few months, but it's there have been created a lot of jobs already. I think like 20 to 50 jobs already. But I want to point out some other thing. So Anna pointed out, I'm working in the north as well. So I'm a colleague of Chris in the north of Amsterdam as well. And there you have this discussion between the low income people and this high income people who come in there and who take over the public space, so to say. I have a community organization in the Northern Park, so that's a public park. And it's really, really difficult to, if you concentrate on people, if you divide your time on all different kind of people, you will come up with some yuppie spaces. So you have to concentrate for 70% of my time is going to these low income people, because you have less networks, less organizational skills. So if you ask somebody with high income to come to the park, he brings 10 friends because he puts it on Facebook and everybody's coming in. these lower-income people just have a network that goes to the end of the street. That's all. So they bring their neighbors. That's all. So you have to be, and that's the problem we are facing also in this building. You have to give them more attention. You can't be democratic and give all people like the same attention. So that's a difficult task for.
It's an interesting analysis. Thank you very much. And I'm just curious about this last point. Yeah, when you're creating shared or inclusive spaces, you should put most of your energy in those with the least access to knowledge, money, networks, because otherwise the more privileged people will take over anyway. Can one of you comment on that analysis?
I totally share what he's saying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Based on what?
Based on examples like that happened in France, in Paris, mm-hmm. In some areas close to they call them centres de rétention administrative. It's not even refugee camps. Mm-hmm. So it's a zone with mixity, high mixity, but very underprivileged people. Mm-hmm. So they try to inject some kind of other kind of social categories and try to create common spaces, common activities. And it's interesting. The approach is interesting. Now, it works, doesn't work. It's based on the experience itself, but the intention is good.
Okay. Good intentions all over the place. How to make them into use, we'll get back to that in a minute. Who else? Uh-huh. In this building, they taught me when you have the microphone, you're not going to give it away. Because otherwise people will start Fidel Castro-like speeches.
Thank you for coming for this side. Actually, I have 2 points I want to comment it. The first one is Mohammed didn't speak about it. The problems that faces the rebuilding of Syria. Very essential point that he didn't notice it. It's the new generation. You know, a lot of children born during these 6 years, and they are set in the war, and the children who are from who born before 10 years, so the range between years from 6 to 16, they are involved now in the war. So this is an a problem now for in Syria. Also, they didn't go to the schools. I have visited a lot of camps in Turkey, and most of them didn't go to school. They act as they are inside Syria. They used to play with games like guns and try to shoot each other in the camp. So this is also a very big problem. Another thing that Bingenst talk about it, which is from his experience in a Zaatari camp, he says that the wheel of economy has go on. And this is also a problem from my point of view, not a solution, because we have a long experience in the Middle East, which is from the Palestinian refugees. A lot of refugees, you know, goes to Lebanon, to Syria, to Jordan. They start with a tent. After years, this tent became a room, and so forth. It becomes much more. It becomes a place like camp, like Khan al-Sheikh and Mukhayyam al-Yarmouk and other places in Jordan and Lebanon. So this is a problem. Also,
sorry, what is the problem here?
The problem here is those people didn't go to their houses. Also, if we speak about the refugees who came from Iraq, 1 million came from Iraq to Syria since 2003 till 2011. These people didn't go back to Syria.
I think the Palestinians would love to go back to their houses if they could, yeah?
For sure, but there isn't opportunity for that. Yeah, this is number one. For people who came from Iraq since 2003 till 2011, more than 1.5 million, they couldn't go back to Iraq, and they go to Europe, to other places for that.
Which is fine with me anyway, but I still don't exactly see the second problem as a problem, but simply human behavior, yeah? But who of you maybe Mohammed or Benguin would like to comment on this first thing, because that is a serious element in any recovery process, this lost generation.
Yeah, it's obviously one of the greatest problems. It was mentioned as education evasion. It's when kids don't go to school anymore, and because they have to work, etc., or go in the streets or whatever. This is a big issue. But to re-educate those children and to catch up with this generation, you need infrastructure, you need spaces. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So.
And you're good at building schools.
I don't know.
That's what you did, yeah?
Yeah, I did several ones, mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's what you will do.
Hopefully, yeah.
I hope so.
Can I, Chris, maybe answer on the challenge question, just because before he forgets it, because he thought we don't think about it. I know about the water problem, the energy problem, all the challenges, the big challenges, the global warming and the agriculture land which is lost in Syria, it's all in the back of our minds. We don't forget it. That's one thing I want to mention on. The second thing also, you mentioned this economy, and I saw that you connected it to also slums in the future, like all the camps happened before, from the Palestinian to the Iraqis. And I think my answer will be, that's why the city of Amsterdam was involved. That's clear answer, because this problem is not from us, it's from the international community, from UNHCR, from all the players there. That's why we were invited to think in development phase instead of thinking of temporary phase. And that's where we explicitly explained also, and we again showed them the camp in Jordan. We went to Baqa and we said, do you want this in 10 years? If you don't want it, then mm-hmm. you need to change something here. That was mm-hmm. our role. So I think that's clear what we're doing.
You're saying a city, Western city like Amsterdam, involves itself in the improvement of the huge refugee camp in the region because we are keeping them there.
Yeah.
And if we don't want them to come here after all, we need to...
And that's another side of the story. Mm. But the part was basically that the way how we deal with temporary emergency is not development yet. We need to change this mindset. And we can also there educate people how they can actually build a city from scratch.
Right.
And that can they take back home with them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That is the future vision.
Yeah.
Natalie is here also from Beirut. She accompanied Mohammed here. You work as the head of design of publications at Solidaire, if I understand correctly. And you would like to ask a question or comment?
Yes, I would like to comment, actually. You want to hold the...
Don't take his mic.
Okay. So, what Mohammed actually commented on is that war stopped in Beirut. It didn't end, and I believe so. So if we build public spaces, then what after these public spaces if the war did not end? And I think that Beirut City Center is a very clear example of why the city center has lost its soul, because usually the center is the place where all different social fabric, different communities gather. Beirut is made up of different religions, and this is where the war started, you know. So I think there was no unifying unity after the war. So, and actually what happened now is that we're facing the same problem. Recently we had a problem with the garbage, you know, we had a garbage problem, a huge one. And that was because of the warlords that stayed in the government, that stayed in the authority, and people went and went to the streets to, you're okay?
I'm listening, no, I'm thinking how I would like to pass on this comment to Arna. Because
this thing,
as you're so curious, you know, about what could we learn from cities like Beirut, this is a quite fundamental question. Yes, we can create public spaces in cities after the conflict, but if the conflict's not solved, if the old power structures are still in place, if the warlords are still in power, then public space will turn into propaganda space, like Mohammed described, instead of a shared space.
Yes, but that's also if you make public spaces that are only based on interests of one group. Of course, the other groups are not going to be there or share that space. So I think it also has to do with that. And I think also in Beirut, well, the stories that I have heard of Solidaire is that they rebuilt parts of the city, but only for the rich. So in that sense, there's also a segregation, and it's not shared.
Mohammed, I mean, the danger of repeating the power structures that destroyed the country in the first place and its effect on the public space after.
Yeah, what's the question?
That is, how do you look at that?
In Lebanon, you mean? Mm.
Or maybe later in Syria?
Well, in Syria it would be a disaster, because it's a bit a bigger country than Lebanon, and the sides are much more, and the international interventions are even much more. Mm-hmm. So if you go there, it's going to be a huge chaos.
Yeah. In the sense that public space, the public domain, the public atmosphere, including the media.
We will fear, we will go back to the fear of the public space again. We will just stay home.
Yeah, yeah. So you would not lift the fear of the public space, which is now there.
Yeah.
So can I have one last question? Uh-huh. You people are... yeah, you should sit here if you want to ask something afterwards.
Thank you. I have a question for Benji and I think also Arna. What you see in a lot of war-torn countries is that first and mostly the intellectuals flee the country first. So my question to you would be, because I get your point that you want to start thinking about rebuilding when the war is still going on, but not the intellectuals are remaining in the city. So who do you plan for? Do you plan for the people that are there who maybe have different interests? And do you plan and do you want to have the intellectuals to come back to the city? Because that would take a different kind of planning than for the people that stay there. So who are you planning for? So that would be my main question. If you start planning ahead, who are you planning for?
That's good question. Mm-hmm. And I'm not planning for anyone at the moment. I'm not making any blueprints. No, I get your point. And my intervention is planting seeds. And I hope you understand the point. I'm planting seeds of the challenges and the difficulties and the lessons we learned in the mind of people. And it doesn't matter if you are in a political position or you are somebody who's standing behind a carriage selling fruits. This is what's important for me, because I think this is what I learned from all the examples that we ignored also. It's not making plans for target groups, because then I'm already segregating. That's what I want to do. Mm-hmm. And I think there's many ways, and it starts with education, of course, and it starts again with throwing seeds here and there and showing different perceptions and perspectives and ways of doing it with different tools what we have in planning and architect, of course. And that's, I think, the most creative part we can think of. That's our profession. We make life for other people, and we don't distinguish if he's politically right or left, right? And if he's poor or highly educated.
Does this whole process, will it include your own return to...
Yeah, of course. Of course.
That's bad news.
Yeah. Hmm? Of course.
But that is your conviction, yeah?
Yeah.
Fine. Now, to end up, can I ask all three of you to answer, I don't know, one question. Now that we've gone through a whole evening of looking at cities in wartime and after and the process of reconstruction, the methods to do so, is there one thing that three of you can come up with that you will take home when you're thinking about preventing further segregation of the cities that we live in? We pronounce a city like this one segregated. We're talking with each other to learn from the processes that went before. So, one thing for now that you're taking home from tonight to prevent
there's
segregation.
Not one, there's not only one thing, Chris, yeah?
I mean, there's 100 things, yeah. But right now you can mention just one. Well, including Beirut, yeah?
I hope we will continue talking, and I actually also hope we can form a group that keeps on talking, maybe meets in different cities. I hope to see you in Beirut also. Mm. And I'm also really curious of your method of the soul of the city. I really want to learn more about that. So I'm definitely going to take that with me.
Okay, you should go into politics. I mean, this is such a polite answer. I want you to come out of this with ideas for methods, for strategies.
Yeah, may,
difficult
may I,
question. Yeah.
Yeah. May I answer? Just it comes out of let's say my heart now at the moment. I think I saw that it's really a critical moment. What I'm taking home with me is that we architects, planners, we city makers, we are not still in charge of the process, and we need to be aware that we are tools being used in the hand of others, and we need to be aware of taking our position. And this is what I'm taking home with me. My position should become stronger, not as an egoistic, centristic person, no, as a professional who understands the city, as a professional who wants to discover more about the city to understand it more. I think this is what I'm taking home with me.
Mohammed?
I think what is very interesting is that we're really talking deeply about public space and its role. Mm. And although we're architects, basically we don't build voids, we build material, mm-hmm. right? We build buildings, not voids. So it's very interesting to see that we are really synchronized to think that if we want democracy, we need to democratic codes and populations, we need to think of the public space. Because if we just compare democratic countries and countries with authoritarian regimes, you can just see it by the use of the public space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we have the syndrome. Yeah. And all over the Middle East, there isn't a single democratic country.
Yeah.
You could just feel it through the public space.
Yeah. Well, that's...
Now, you were mentioning the case in Amsterdam, the mm-hmm. segregation, etc. But you're far beyond. You're so... I mean, it's totally democratic.
Sure.
With some maybe sure. wounds, sure. small... Yeah.
Sure, but that's why I think it's such a relevant initiative of Arna and the Balie to be alert and to look at our own city in order for it to remain way beyond, or to take other cities with it. Can I ask you the same question once again, Arna? Or
yeah, I think what I've learned, you say you should become a politician, but I think I really want to be busy with knocking on the doors of politicians. And going to that higher political level to also make a connection to bridge that gap, because that is a big problem.
Of course, I was only kidding, and I.
Yeah, I know.
God forbid that you go into politics, because we need you here. But I agree. That was one of the things that struck me as well. That your work, the work that you're doing, including the mobilization of kindred spirits like this, needs to resonate on a higher political level too. So it's a big job, but we only just started. So I want to thank all of you for your patience. I want to invite you to return here on the 2nd of June, when we will discuss the shared cultural heritage. Yeah. All right, there we are in segregated cities, and 20th of September. So I want to invite you all to go with us through steps 2 and 3, go with us through the long phases that Mohammed has predicted will lie ahead. And I want to thank Mohammed Al-Mufti, Arna Mackic, and Bengin Dawood a lot for your
thank
input.
You.
Thank you.